Blog Talk Radio.
Hello. Thank you for joining us tonight, everyone. I am Minister Annie Bell, the host and creator of IRAIN Blog Talk Radio Show, which is an outreach of Wealth Management Ministries Incorporated. We are endeavoring to bring talk therapy to survivors of child abuse, sex trafficking, and other traumas, as well as providing awareness, prevention, and resources to the community. We have a treat for you today. It is our debut of Author's Corner. This segment will spotlight authors or books that promote and propel the vision of IRAIN Blog Talk Radio Show. So we will take a book and we will discuss it, talk about it, break it apart, you know, find out the inspiration behind it, talk to the writer of it, and gain intimate insight on what the inspirations were for the book. So grab you a cup of Joe or a hot beverage, your favorite cuddle blanket, and cozy up the fireplace as you listen in. But before I begin, I want to give a round of applause to my husband, Lloyd B., and my father-in-love, Lloyd Sr. They are the team of recovery just for today. Experience, strength, and hope. No shame, just recovery, one day at a time. We are so grateful to be part of Never Had It So Good Sports Media Network with Mrs. Princess Cooper at the helm as CEO. Okay, well, the spotlight this hour will shine on Khalilah Johnson out of Bemore, Maryland. She is the author of Undefeated, Broken Into Purpose. So if everybody could just stay tuned for just a second. We have a quick a technical refreshing that we have to do. So listen to this commercial and we'll be right back.
Hi, I'm Curtis Stone, and this is Bilo's Cooking with Curtis for under $10. This month, I've chosen tomatoes from Bilo's fantastic fresh produce. So come on, click here and let's eat well for less.
Hey, this is Minister Annie Bell. Did you know that you can advertise your business, ministry, or product during my show? Expose your business to approximately 1.8 million sets of eyes and ears because we are on the platform of Never Had It So Good Sports Media Network. That's right. Yes, you can. We have some great rates and packages to meet just about any marketing budget. Give us a call at 678-342-6607 or look us up on www.wealthmngt.org or even catch up with us on Facebook at IRAIN Stop Abuse and Fight Back. Promote your business and help a wonderful cause. Now that's what I call a win-win.
All right. Welcome back. Thank you for that moment so I could get my stuff together on the board here. So we have in the studio with us Mrs. Khalilah Johnson. Khalilah, you with us?
Yes, I am. How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Bless. Praise God.
Amen. You know, I used to live in Oxon Hill, Maryland for about half a minute. Is that far?
It's about an hour, 45 minutes possibly. Hello?
Hello, could you hear me?
I can hear you now.
Oh, okay. I said that I used to live in Oxon Hill, Maryland for about half a minute. Is that far from where you live?
About 45 minutes.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I lived there. I moved there right out of high school and in my attempts to kind of run away from all my past hurt, and I moved in with my cousin. I got a job making $4.10 an hour, catching 5 buses and 3 trains to get to work. So that lasted, like I said, just about a minute and a half because I had to get back home and regroup. So, but anyway, I am excited to have you on as our first guest for this new segment called the Author's Corner. Actually, you not know it, but you were my inspiration for this segment because after hearing about your book launch, I really wanted to be able to help survivors who are trying to be a light or a help to other survivors to thrive. So, you know, what that mean, everybody out there in radio land, I'm trying to say please buy the book because, you know, when I was reading through it, I'm going to tell you, so intense at some of the points that I had to kind of put it down for a second. But it was great. The ending was so motivational and so inspirational. But I'm not going to, you know, give up all the stuff because I want to talk about it a little bit today. We also have two people who have also read her book, and they were, you know, handpicked because I believe they had some profound things that they wanted to pull out from the book. Their names are Aisha Hunter and Alvina Bell. Welcome, ladies, to the studio.
Hi, how are
Hello.
You?
Hello.
All right, I'm doing good. Thank you for being on the call with us. And, you know, this I think it'll make for a very dynamic discussion. But even more, I just want to thank you for buying her book and reading it. So so what we're going to do, just so that everyone will know, that we're gonna, a little bit further down, we're going to allow you to pick your favorite passage and read it. And then we're just going to get into some discussion. But first, I wanted to talk with Khalilah and ask about, you know, a little bit about the book. What made you want to write this book about your life?
Wow. I really can't say that I had decided to write the book. I can't say that I was called to write the book. It was 2013, and it was the middle of the night, and I woke up, and the Holy Spirit said, write this down. And I wrote a passage down, and I didn't look at it again. And then in probably about April, I started to go to counseling and started to just unpack some things again in 2014. And so when I went to counseling, the first thing that the counselor says after our session is, you're going to write several books. God wants me to tell you that you're going to write several books.
Wow.
During that process, it was just like I started to tell my story. The more I could talk about it with the counselor, the more I started to tell it, and the more I started to share it in church. And so it was about December 2014 that I shared a testimony. And the church, there were many people that were crying and said, you told my story. While I was on stage, my church has a website that you can they can play the sermon immediately. And there was a very high official in our church, the conference of our church, that was actually just happening to watch it. And before I got off the stage, he was on the phone saying, God told me to help you write a book. It was
wow.
That process. And so in January, I started to fast and literally waking up in the middle of the night, and that was this year. And I started to fast, and I started, the Lord would just wake me up in the middle of the night, and he got me through it. And this is the weirdest part about it is that before this time frame, I would never say that I was an author or a writer or someone that communicates in writing. As a matter of fact, I tell people often, I am someone that had a problem with text messages. Like, I just, like, just call me. I'm a better communicator, not really good at writing. But God said, it doesn't matter what you think you are. Sometimes we have gifts that we don't even know we have because they're locked behind trauma and anxiety. And so I had to start repeating to myself, I am an author. I know that was the Holy Spirit saying, I am an author, so that he can lock what he placed inside of me so that my story could be used for his glory. So it's really just that, it's just a story. I didn't decide it.
Wow. But you know what? I have found that when it's the Holy Ghost inspired, I mean, you can write and you can do things that you didn't think you could ever do, you know,
right.
That you didn't even know was in there. But way before, you know, you even was born, he knew you before the womb, and he had, you know, your gifts and your talents and your anointing.
Mm-hmm.
And so he begins to then pull out that which he had put in. And I wanted to also make a point. And I know, you know, when you said people were saying, hey, you were telling my story, you know, it's because, one, that perverse, unholy spirit has used so many people to violate so many people. And and I know the number is the very conservative number is like 800,000 a year of children being abused, but it's more like a million. And if you think about every year, a million kids in just the United States being abused, it's absolutely an epidemic. And I did a show a couple months ago, and I said if it was polio or HIV AIDS or any other epidemic, the government would rally around and truly find, try their best to find a cure. And but I don't see that happening. And I don't know what it is. I don't know if it's because it's the infringement of privacy or, you know, people, they're saying, hey, people can raise their kids the way they want, but come on, some people need some help. Amen.
Yeah, amen.
I thank you for your bravery to write the book. And and I, you know, I want to go into a little bit. You've been on my show before, and so you have talked about some of the things that you have suffered at the hands of your victimizers. But for those who may not have heard that show, if you could kind of give us a quick rundown of what happened. And then we want to go ahead and start to dissect your book. But, yeah, tell us, you know, when did this start? When did your abuse start, and who was your abuser?
Well, there were several. I start off in the book speaking about the earliest memory I can remember, and I can imagine myself being about 3 years, and I remember sitting on someone's lap and them touching me underneath for years after that. That was just inappropriate touching by a babysitter. And from that point forward, it was trauma at the hands of a stepdad who was abusing my mother. I just saw violent acts, threatening to kill her. He had threatened when I was about 6 years old that he was going to stab her, and he told me to get a knife. Constantly seeing yelling, trauma, and experiencing physical abuse from him, even to the point where our when we, and I say we, me and my sisters were beat, our bodies would be bloodied. Just trauma after trauma after trauma, and it was just something that you kind of expected, not understanding it. So,
wow. And, you know, we actually can, as humans, we can adapt so well even to the worst of conditions. And you said you just kind of got used to it, and you were probably almost anticipating some of it because – That was the environment. That was what you learned. And you know, for those who are out there listening, if you're in a domestic violence or domestic abuse situation, your children, when even seeing them being, seeing the mother being or father, there are some women who abuse. So I'm not going to be, you know, prejudiced in what I'm saying, but there are some women who abuse their men, but it is traumatic to even see that or see constant or hear constant yelling at your spouse, you know, whether threatening to kill them or anything like that. Even if they don't lay not one finger on them, it's still abusive and it's still very traumatic to children. And so I also like the fact that you had mentioned that you actually got some counseling. Is that right?
Yes, I did. I stayed with my grandma. Three separate occasions that I got counseling. Well, probably it was four, but three that I remember that I willfully went. One, when I was about 9 years old, my grandmother took the initiative to make sure that I was in counseling when I went to go stay with her after an episode for my stepdad and my mom. And then again, when I was 13, which I probably wasn't very I didn't want to go. And then there again, when after I had my last son, which was about 2003, I started going to counseling, and then again in 2014. And so I know that it is so necessary to be able to talk about it with someone that is not emotionally connected
to it.
You can
say that 14 more times, because that is so true. I mean, and that's why this show is it's talk therapy. It also helps the person who has been victimized, who actually has been is a survivor and is talking about it, and it also mm-hmm. helps those who are hearing it, because it gives them confidence and also makes them not feel like they are alone. So I am a poster child for, you know, counseling. And but, you know, so like I said, I can't say that enough. I myself never had official counseling, and I wish I did. Mm-hmm. I didn't know really about it afterwards. I did a lot of self-help books, and then, of course, when I was going through mm-hmm. college and, you know, getting my degree in psychology and Christian counseling and religion, that is where, you know, God counseled me. But mm-hmm. that's mm-hmm. not for everyone. There's people who right. need that. I'm going to take a quick break, and this is probably going to be my first and my last, because I want to make sure we get everything in and give you really time to breathe and tap into yourself and talk about this book and talk about your experience. So give me a brief minute. I'm gonna do my due diligence here and do my, you know, pay the bill, and then I'm going to come right back and we'll break apart this book, okay? Hold on, everybody, just one moment.
A better network, as explained by an abnormally large basketball hoop. When a wireless network has bigger capacity, more data gets through more quickly. Score. Better matters. Verizon.
Hi, Maurice Robinson with New Potential. We're out of Florida. You're listening to I Rain Law Talk Radio Show with your host, Minister Annie Bell. Join her every Thursday night at 8 p.m.
Hi, my name is Abigail Bell out of Atlanta, Georgia, and you are listening to I Rain Law Talk Radio Show with my mom, host, Minister Annie Bell. You can catch her every Thursday at 8 p.m. on Never Had It So Good Sports Media Network.
Wonderful. Everybody, that was my little girl. I think she did a wonderful job doing a little commercial for her mom. So, woo, Azriel, you did good. But anyway, so now we're back, everybody. My name is Annie Bell, and you're listening to IRAIN Blog Talk Radio Show. And again, what we do here, what we endeavor to do here, is to bring talk therapy to the masses. We want you to hear and be ministered to all at the same time, and possibly even allow you to help thrive in your life. That's our main goal. We want you to heal. We want you to survive, and we want you to turn around and help others, like Khalilah is doing now with her book and being so courageous in coming out and talking about such a horrendous, horrific experience that she has gone through. Now, Khalilah, I absolutely love the title of the book. It's in a nutshell, it tells that, hey, you have gone through something, you were not defeated, and not only that, that doggone thing broke you into your purpose, you know? So
yeah.
How did you come up with that name? Did God give it to you?
I would say so, definitely. The Undefeated was actually the minister, the high official minister that's a part of our conference. He came to me and he says, listen, God told me it's going to be undefeated because you're undefeated. And he gave me that name. And then there were many other subtitles that I went through. And it was not until the last minute that I heard the Holy Spirit say, broken into purpose. So he changed that. And I know that that was Holy Spirit inspired, because that's the only way. Nothing else felt like it fit. But when I heard that, just broken into purpose, it explained everything. Because that's exactly, I felt like I had been broken, and I'm being broken, but not broken to be broken permanently, but broken into purpose, being shaped and molded for God's use.
Yes. And when I read it, when I first read the word broken, in my mind, because I'm a very visual person, so in my mind I visualized, you know, when people say God. But then when I read it further, it was like broken into pieces, but it was broken, not that it was broken into pieces, but it was broken into purpose. So thing that was supposed to kill you and to break you, but it actually propelled you into where you were supposed to go. And so I think it's phenomenal, and that's just how manifold our God is. He could take anything in our lives that we have gone through and make it glorify him. So, again, the title of the book, I think, is phenomenal. As I said earlier, before our break, I had said that we had invited two others, and we're going to go into the portion now where we're actually going to pick some passages that really spoke to us. And I'm going to start just because, you know, this is all about Khalilah today. I'm going to allow Khalilah to go ahead and tell us the passage that you selected, and then we're going to discuss it a little bit. And what's your inspiration behind that?
Okay. I'm having a little bit of difficulties breaking up a little bit. But my passage in the book is on page 96, and it says, "I was fuming on the inside. Whenever I looked at the ring with that speck of dust, diamond dust, I felt irritated. I asked him what he had gotten his family, and as he listed the awesome gifts he gave everyone in his family, it only made me feel worse. He didn't get me this cheap ring because he was broke, but because I had given him the impression that I didn't really believe I deserved much more. I knew I had done that. Still, if you found that I was valuable, why not give me what I deserve rather than what you can get away with? It made me aware of how I was presenting myself, but I didn't know how to change it."
Wow. So this basically, he had given you a diamond where, like you said, it was a dust, but everyone else, he gave gifts that he felt worthy enough for them, he esteemed them pretty high, whereas with you, he didn't. Tell us a little bit about that. And the background here, folks, is that after her abuse as a child, now she is with a man who now is abusive to her, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Go ahead. Tell us about that.
Well, what I found is that my perception of self-worth, it always was shaped around what I was made to feel, what I had seen my mom go through, what I experienced. It always, it's something about how you're developed in it. You can even see it, you can understand it, but you don't know how to break away from the self-esteem issues that you present yourself as lowly. And it's almost even nonverbal. I walked into a relationship with this man who says, "I love you. I love you. I want to marry you." But, you know, he knew that my self-esteem was not that high. He knew that he wanted to possess this woman, but the greatest thing for him was to have something that was worth more, that he didn't have to treat better because I didn't know my own worth. And to know and be able to see, to be smart enough to be able to see that I wasn't presenting and portraying myself like who God made me, and not knowing how to walk in it because I've never seen a woman be self-assured and know her worth.
So. Amen. And this, again, you know, and I'm going to do a show about fatherless homes. Even though you had a father figure, he did not really put into you what a father is supposed to for a daughter.
No.
And if the father's role is really so very important. And for both boys and girls, I'm not going to say one or the other. And so you didn't have your father speak that into you, your validation, your virtue, your esteem. He didn't have that. And then on the other hand, you saw how your mother was being treated. And so, of course, it paved the way to say, okay, well, you know, I must be nothing either. And so, it's you know, I've seen my mother be treated this way, so I guess this is how I'm supposed to be treated. But I think something deep down in you, deep down in your knower, you knew that you were worth more than that diamond dust. You were worth more than what they were giving. And I think that fueled you to continue reaching for. You think the same thing?
Huh?
Hear me?
I can hear you now. I apologize. I just broke up.
It's okay. And I think it's that I'm in Georgia, and so we just had a horrific flooding in our area. So I don't know if that has something to do with my the connection, but I apologize if that's what that is.
No problem. It was difficult because, you know, on one end, you know what it's wrong. You know you can point out that is what's wrong, but you don't quite know how to get to right.
Mm-hmm.
Just being able to know it was it's even more difficult because at least I would have been able to accept, not at least, but I would have accepted it. But to know better, but not know how to do better, was a very
mm-hmm.
difficult trap to be in mentally and emotionally.
Yeah. I also want to talk about the fact that in many instances, about 85% of women and children, well, children, excuse me, not women, mm-hmm. but children who have been abused, they go through what's mm-hmm. known as re-victimization. And so there is a feeling of inferiority, vulnerability
mm-hmm.
once a person mm-hmm. goes through that type of trauma. And so when faced with yet another situation where they might be in danger, they feel like they don't have a way to defend themselves and that, okay, this is just, I guess, the way life is supposed to be. And so that cycle has to be broken. And so I want to applaud you because when you went to therapy, when your grandmother put you in therapy, that was one of the steps, one of the the important elements of you breaking your cycle, and so I want to applaud you and your grandma for that, and I think that's wonderful. I know, like I said, for me, going through what I went through as a child and not knowing my self-worth, but like deep down, I knew I wasn't meant just for the pleasures of men, you know, to be had with my body. And to be hit and abused and talked down to like I'm nothing. I knew it. I just, like you said, I just didn't know how to turn around and because we're so young at that time, you know. So that is wonderful. I want to then call on Aisha Hunter. Are you there? Can you hear me? And am I saying your name properly? Aisha Hunter?
Hello.
Okay. Hi.
Hi,
I think you picked out a passage. And if you could read it, and then if you had a question for Khalilah, you can go ahead and ask.
I picked it from chapter 3 on page 23. It reads, "Now she would not be the only one to introduce me to the spirit of perversion. There were several situations of children going too much. As I look back, I could see that there were traps of the enemy set up over and over again to expose my sisters and me. I knew that God was displeased and I felt responsible. My mom was so deluded, she felt like she was unsafe. But because of her own abuse, her mind failed to flag her for danger. By not taking the time to address her own issues, instead of running from, she flocked to shady characters. Without deliverance, she would remain a victim and produce victimized children."
Wow.
I want to ask Khalilah, how do you think this played out in you being a mother yourself?
I repeated the same cycle. It is. That's exactly what happened. It was in everything that I did, all I knew was how, you know, don't send them here. Don't do this. Don't do that. But everybody that I brought in my life reflected the same people that I had seen my mom bring in, the same relationships. I repeat it. And so in the same manner, I was just following the footsteps. And the very thing that I focused on all the things that my mother had done wrong. And without knowing it, I blindly repeated them like a blueprint.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so when as my daughter, you know, grew, there were experiences that, you know, in my mind, I was focusing on the things that traumatized me the most. And by focusing on those things, I actually created an opening, untouched and uncovered, for when my daughter was attacked, and she was also raped at the same age that I was.
the cycle repeated itself.
Now, I didn't know about that, Khalilah. I didn't know that about your daughter. And, wow, that just sent chills up my spine because you see that it's generational. It's a generational curse and attack. And, again, you took a stance, not only in the natural, but in the spiritual by what you're with what you're doing, you know? Wow, I'm just floored. And so you say your daughter was 3 when she was raped, and she was she raped by someone she knew?
Well, she was raped when she was 14. I was raped when I was 14. I was molested
14.
When I was 3,
I'm
but
sorry.
I was raped. Yeah. And at 14, and, you know, I also had her at 14. And so at 14, she was raped. It was almost as if, you know, it was the same age, around the same age that my mother was raped. You know, this thing that kept happening generation after generation, it was almost as if nobody's going to rape her. I'm going to watch her. I'm going to do this and I'm going to do that. But in actuality, it happened again. And, you know, it's the very reason that all I could do was pray and, like, you know, ask God. I don't know how to change this. I don't know how to fight these demons, but I know that this is something that is so deeper than me. This was before me, and if you don't stop it, Lord, it's going to be after me. So watching her, knowing that is the worst thing that you can experience, because the helplessness of experiencing having to find out that your child went through exactly the same thing, I now understood. Even while my mother didn't handle it the way that I assumed that in her shoes I would have handled it. Because the pain is so deep that it actually can take you over.
Mm.
So, you know, until you're in the actual shoes of what happens when you have to address your child, and especially when you haven't dealt with properly your own rape, and having to experience that pain twice, literally you feel yourself having to hold on for dear life to every bit of emotional breath and say, I can't deal with this right now. I know you want me to help you right now, and I know you're in pain, but I can't handle your pain. The only thing I can tell you to do is what I've known to do. Get up and keep moving. That's all I can give you, because that's all I ever did. I don't know how to handle it. I didn't deal with my own.
Wow. And that was, and I was going to ask you that, you know, what emotions flooded you when you found out that your daughter was raped?
I felt like someone was attacking me. I felt that I wanted to run. I wanted to run away from her. I literally wanted to escape the information, because I didn't know what to do with it. I didn't know how to process it. She's telling me something right now at a place that I'm trying to climb out of a hole, and she's telling me something that could either emotionally cripple me when I just fought to stand again, and at the same time helpless. I can't do anything about it. I can't get your attacker. I can't go and fight for you. I don't even know who to fight. There was no one to go press charges against. There was nothing that I could do except be wounded. And then at that moment, I just wanted to run, because you're being confronted with yourself. And you never I ran from my own rape. I never dealt with it until adulthood. So now I have to repeat the cycle, and I have no tools, nothing to give her. We're only 14 and a half years apart. I don't know what to give you. I've not been here. I've never been able to heal from this. Now, all I could do is just say, okay, so let's keep moving, okay? That's all I could give her, was a pep talk. I felt like I was giving her a motivational speech, like, get back up, let's go, let's move, let's just do it, pray, let's go. And at that very moment, I felt myself repeating the way that I saw my mom handle it, like, oh, this didn't happen, it's not that bad, let's go, let's just go, let's pick up, let's dust it off, let's just go. And not understanding until that very moment, that's what she was dealing with. It wasn't that she didn't care. She just didn't know how. How do you deal with that? Literally, it's like a boulder being hit, and you don't know, I still got to work. I still got to survive. I still got to supply your needs. I can't do both. I can't do both. Yeah.
And, you know, there's a book out called, it's a Time for a Village Meeting by Cheryl Lynn. How, you know, we have a generation of mothers who have been hurt But mm-hmm. and so and then they're raising up another generation of daughters and not knowing how to relate to them and help them, and so they become dysfunctional mm-hmm. as well. And so it's like yeah. we carry that forth. And I'm going to tell you, I was scared to have kids for the longest time because, you know, I heard that abuse. And then I didn't want to bring any children into this world because all I see is pain. All I saw was mm-hmm. pain, perversion. Mm-hmm. I was disgusted with life, you know. And mm-hmm. I tried to even take my own life at the age mm-hmm. of 16 because I'm thinking if this is all life is about. you can go ahead and take me back because I don't even you know want to mm-hmm. be here. And I remember rejecting God. And hated him for maybe about 10 years. I didn't come to Christ till I was 30 years old. And, you know, one thing about a lot of the survivors, the survivor responses for us, there's some that become stuck and get stymied, but there's some of us who throw ourselves into our careers and we become very successful in that arena, but then we turn around over here on the other compartments of like relationship and stuff like that, and it's just nothing but a mess, you know. And that was me. I was just like, okay, I'm just going to stay focused on this thing right here, this career path right here, because that's the only area that looks is working out. And and so I even told my employees, if you ever come to me talking about this Jesus, I am going to fire you. I told my mom that I'm going to stop seeing her coming over. I don't need nothing from you if you're going to keep trying to, you know, convert me. And but really the enemy wanted to keep me from the very cure.
Yes.
Yes. You know, that was going to set me free. And so, you know, I tell you, what it looks like to me also by reading your book is that church was never too far from you. You kept church, you kept Christ pretty close. Is that right?
Yeah. Yes. But as you said, there was, you know, I grew up in the church. My family grew up in the church as far as I can remember. And church also represented such a hurt for me that people that did not understand the pain that happens through children who have been abused, or the family that comes to church with children out of wedlock, and you see that, and they actually represented to me at that time God. So for a moment I rejected God because that's who I thought they were. I thought God was judgmental. I thought he hated my family. I thought that he disliked us, and that all I saw was my mom pray, but then I saw my mom be traumatized. All I knew is that we came to church all the time, but we went back home to a man who was evil, and her reality was that God wouldn't want her to be a divorce. So she stayed in a relationship because of this God who's supposed to love us, but actually he seems like he hates us. So there was a rejection of him. So I had to find him when I left the church. Well, actually, he found me. He had to come and get me at my most broken place. A place where I tried to kill myself. I wanted to be out of here. I had taken matters in my own hands, and I had just made a mess of my life. Everything that I had blamed my mother for, it seemed like I did worse. And so without God, even though that, you know, I looked at her and said, why would you have a life and still be praying? She knew to pray. I didn't.
Mm-hmm.
I rejected that philosophy because to me it didn't work. So leaving there, he came and sought me at my lowest point, and he showed me things. He gave me vision of me speaking at a time that I was locked inside my own mind, just coming from trying to kill myself. So God found me and showed me that he was, in fact, a loving God. And he said, all of that fight in you, I put that in you. But let me show you how to really fight. I'm going to show you how to fight in the spirit. These are demons that are after your family. And you will be able to walk in freedom. You just got to accept it and give me everything. Give me everything. And then I could come back and face these people that I once saw as judgmental. And I still dealt with judgmental people, but they no longer represented God. God represented God. And I was able to walk in freedom. And I'm walking in freedom and still being broken as we speak.
Amen. And, you know, the father for kids is a representation for us, the Heavenly Father. And so when there is a deficit, mm-hmm. when there is a severance, it convolutes our relationship with the Heavenly Father, you know.
Yes.
And that is, again, mm-hmm. why it is so important, the Father's role inside of the home. And your you know, perception of the Heavenly Father was disjointed because of this earthly father who obviously was too abusive, you know, very abusive. So we can see that. I want to make sure I give time for our last book reader, Alvinia Bell. Did I say your name right? Okay.
Alvinia.
I don't know. We might be related. Bell is my married name, but you might know my husband. But share with us the page and passage that was profound to you.
We're in chapter 16 on page 136. It starts with, I was 8 months pregnant by then. I started to take his clothes out of the closet. He says sternly, don't touch my clothes again. I said, or what? As I grabbed his hats and put them in his suitcase. He balled up his fist and punched me in the eye. I collapsed onto the floor and laid there in total shock. Surely this argument was not that serious, I thought. My thoughts were racing. Why did he just hit me like that? I thought about getting up and defending myself, but held back because of my unborn son. I didn't know what to expect, so I stayed still. As I lay there in disbelief, my husband walked out of the room. When he came back, I was preparing for his I'm so sorry and I don't know what just came over me speech. What he said next surprised me more than the punch to the face. He said, don't call the police or you won't have any money for your baby. Then he walked out of the house. Wait, what? No remorse? Wow. Who did I just marry? So my question for you is, how come you didn't heed the red flag?
My fear. That actually wasn't the first red flag. That was the first time he hit me, but that definitely wasn't the first red flag. The red flag came so many times beforehand. I think when you experience so much abuse, especially, you know, I compared every relationship that I had to what I saw my mom go through. And because of my justification and my need to blame her for everything, I actually created in my mind, as long as it's not as bad as what she did, I'm okay. As long as he didn't do what he did, he's okay. See, my barometer for an abusive man is very way off from what most people may be having a radar for. That was the first time he hit me, but that wasn't the first time he was emotionally and emotionally abusive to me. But as long as he didn't try to kill me yet. And even at that point, he only had, you know, at that moment, even though I was so confused, because that to me was the worst, because I didn't understand how someone hit someone without being angry and rage. You know, what did I just happen to? You know, that's a whole nother arena. I've seen an enraged man go off on a woman or want to kill someone. But when you deal with someone that didn't have an emotion and just decided, I'm just going to hit you, where does that come from and what is that? At that moment, I didn't leave, because the reason that I married him in the first place was fear. Fear of what am I going to do with my children? My fear of not being able to supply for my kids or being without because of what I had gone through kept me in a relationship with a man who I thought was a good supplier. But maybe he's not a good man. I can handle it. He hasn't beat my kids yet. That was the reasoning from an abused mind, a victim's mind.
Wow. I mean, because your barometer is broken.
Yeah.
You know, at that time, because you're saying, hey, this is not abuse until, I mean, he hasn't hit me yet, you know, or hit the kids yet, or, okay, well, that was just one bad word, or, you know, all right, well, that was only the third time. But it really, all it is are just steps towards, you know, the insanity, the steps towards that person's, the abuser's insanity. And also kind of like, well, how do you boil a frog? You know, frog is pretty jumpy. Right. How do you boil them? Well, you just got to turn that heat up a little bit at a time. You can't just.
Yeah.
They slowly get you
Yeah.
and make you kind of feel like, okay, well, this is not that bad. It's not too hot yet, you know.
Yeah.
By the time it's too hot for most women, they have already been cooked. They're dead. And so I praise God that something, the red flag was finally big enough. It was loud enough, and it was waving in your face enough for you to finally say this is over. Those were some great passages, and very profound, ladies, Aisha and Alvinia. Thank you for that. I have one that it just really stuck with me. Now, for those who don't know, Khalilah Johnson also has a Facebook page. And on her Facebook page, you know, Khalilah, you were talking about forgiveness, and this really touched me because I know I had to go through that myself. But on page 207, you say, Lord, if you don't help me forgive this man, my anger will destroy me and he would have won. I want you to talk about that, and I want you to link it to that post that you put up about forgiveness. And tell me your thoughts, because it was so profound how you knew that if you did not forgive this man, he would have won anyway.
The rage. Through my life, I had experienced rage, uncontrollable rage. When I was a child, temper tantrums, temper anger, that would be so explosive that I literally felt like I would black out in anger. And so as God started to come to me and bring me the understanding of teaching me, the first thing he had me do was forgive my mother and forgive myself. And so that was even before I had completely left that situation. But when I, outside of the marriage, looking at the damage that my children had suffered, looking at all that I had lost, looking at all that I had to now recover and all the work that now had to be done emotionally just to do the normal, I felt like I had been taking so many steps downward and backward. Mm-hmm. And I was no longer myself. I was a weaker version of myself. At least that's what it felt like. With less, I didn't have anything. I was, I had been pretty much mentally just coming back from a breakdown. And so the reality was I was sitting in this place looking around me at my circumstances, not knowing how I was going to get past this. And on top of it, if I didn't stop thinking about him dying, because that's really what happens, it's just sitting there, and the more I saw my kids go through what I went through, that was double the emotions of pain and anger. Mm. You know, it's one thing when I go through it, but when you see your children go through it, and it all, I married him so that they didn't have to suffer, and my distorted view, and here they are suffering just as I had suffered, and even worse, they have to see me in a place that I don't belong. They had to see things that they should have never experienced from me, and I knew that I would be destroyed. The anger was coming, like just coming up and bubbling up inside of me, and I didn't want to hate him. I was so determined at that moment that, you know, I was sitting there like, he wanted to destroy me. I'm stubborn. So when you know that the reality was is that he deliberately tried to destroy me, and that stubbornness was like, you're not going to destroy me, and if I've got to forgive you, so that you don't win, that's going to be my drive for right now. That's all I can have. I don't know how to not. It's not helping me at all. You're over there. You get to live. You get to walk. You get to go back to work. I've got to fight to do the daily routines. I've got to fight for my kids now. Now all the damage that you've left behind, it's not fair. And if I focus on how it looked like you just got to walk away, then I would be broken. I would stay broken. So I knew I had to forgive him, and I was stubborn about it. I'm going to forgive you.
Yes. And you know, that's a principle of God, and so you know employing it will work. For me, it was hard because I had said, okay, I forgive my trespassers. You know, I forgive him for what he did and the abuse, but deep down in my heart, I hadn't forgiven. I had malice in my heart. There were times when I was in the midst of my abuse and still a minor, I was And I think I recall I was about 12, maybe 11, and I watched Quincy, I believe, and that's how I first knew. And, you know, I know I'm dating myself at this point, but it was a show called Quincy, and he was a, you know, what was that, a forensic scientist or a forensic doctor or whatever, and he unveiled that molestation is wrong. You know, you're not supposed to do these things to kids. And so I was like, yes, I knew that was not right, you know, because my abusers wanted to tell me that that's what little girls were supposed to do, was to satisfy men. And so, but anyway, I saw this other movie where the girl was, had, you know, was talking to this guy about killing her abuser. And so I said, you know what, maybe I can do that. Because I was so filled with anger and so frustration, so much frustration and sadness while this person is still living their lives, going, doing what they're doing, you know, having a good time. And I'm in turmoil. I am tortured every day with the memories of what you have done to me. And you're out there having a good time. And when I got saved and the Lord said, you got to forgive him, I thought, you've got to be joking, right? Did you see what he did to me? Did you see what he said? Did you hear what he said to me? You know, did you see him slap me so hard, you know, that I had stars in my eyes and, you know, it had a cut on my eye? You're saying I got to forgive him, you know? And so I want to read the definition of forgiveness, because I think that your book truly embraces it. It says, forgiveness is the intentional and voluntary process by which a victim undergoes a change in feelings and attitude regarding an offense. Let go of negative emotions such as vengefulness with an increased ability to wish the offender well. Forgiveness is different from condoning, failing to see the action as wrong and in need of forgiveness, or excusing, not holding the offender as responsible for the action, pardoning granted by a representative of society such as a judge, or forgetting, removing awareness of the offense from consciousness and reconciliation. That's not what it is. It's truly about exercising our right to say, I'm not going to allow you to keep me forever bound in the thing that you have done. And in Matthew 6:15, it says, but if you do not forgive others their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. And so that really sank deep with me, because I thought, well, gosh, I'm not perfect. So I have sinned. So that means, Lord, you're not going to forgive me. And so I finally said, well, Lord, how, tell me how to do it, you know, because I don't want to sin by not forgiving. And and I want to do, I want to live right by God. So he said, he gave me something that helped me. And what, and I hope that it's going to help the other listeners as well, is that he said it was not the man who violated me. It was really the perverse spirit, the unholy spirit that was oppressing and some possessing them to do those things. And so, and he said, but I love the sinner. I hate the sin, but I love the sinner. And so he said, Annie, learn, I'm about to cry. He said, learn to love the sinner, but hate the sin, hate the devil, because the Bible says we could hate Satan. And so I was able to funnel my hate, my disgust, and at the right entity, so that I can forgive this Muppet of a man who the enemy was using with his strings to do those things to me. And so I was able to forgive truly. I could be around this person still and not cringe and not have the desire to pull his eyes out from the back of his head. I mean, that's how that's how fierce my anger was, you know. So that's the kind of God we serve. Like you said in the book that you serve such a graceful God. And that's the God we serve. We got about 2 minutes before we have to say goodbye. This has been an awesome time. Again, you know.
Yeah.
Awesome. Could you share with us how to get your book, number one, how to get in contact with you, because I know you are a motivational speaker as well, and, you know, what you're doing now to continue to propel your mission?
My book is on Amazon, and you can look up Undefeated, Broken Into Purpose. Look up Khalilah Johnson, or I'm the only Khalilah Johnson. And also, I'm selling it on my website, which is Undefeatable. The book is Undefeated, and my ministry is called UndefeatableMinistries.com. And you can find the events and things that I'm doing there. I have a few speaking engagements the beginning of this year, and as well as just working with children. And really, I find it very, very helpful for me to work with teenagers, you know, at-risk teenagers, and those that are needing to understand, being able to unpack it and seeing it at a younger age, being able to identify what abuse looks like, to be able to teach that. And so that is really something that God has placed heavily on my heart, and so that's moving forward. But those are the ways that you can reach me as well.
That's wonderful. And I wanted to ask you a little bit more about Undefeatable Ministries. What else do you do? I know you work with a lot of children, right?
Yeah, I teach them on the weekends, and I have seminars at different times. I've gone to TAB workshops for teenagers. I've visited schools and high schools just to speak to them about all types of things. We deal with social injustice. We deal with one of the things that I like to talk about is unpack the impact. We deal with generational blessings and curses, helping them to identify the hereditary, you know, in order to break a curse or break something that is happening over and over again, you've got to identify the root of the cause. And so you can start to pick up things that you are susceptible to, you know, that are in your family. Sometimes we just move so quickly. We just move throughout our life and we try to figure things out on our own. But if we can start to identify, we'll know how to stay away, but also we'll know how to heal faster. We'll know how to move faster. We'll know how, and just teaching them things that represent induced fear. There's a lot of things happening in the media right now that are inducing fear and trauma and how that affects your perception. As a child, you know, a lot of the things that we're having to deal with as adults happens as children. It happens through the trauma and even things that we don't identify as being traumatic. We might not experience it, but we may watch something on TV that still happens to change our perception. And so helping children and identify that, and also speaking to women. I speak to women all the time and mentor women, and the thing that I see is that by giving my story and speaking to the story, all of a sudden that becomes an eye-opener for them. Like, wait a minute, I never thought of it like that. I never identified that root cause is the reason why I do this today. Embracing telling our truth. Because the enemy hides behind secrets and lies and distortion, and he keeps
and
us.
We can
justify the things that we go through. If we justify it, he's got us.
Amen.
We are justifying the way that we are and why we're that way, instead of just saying, "Lord God, give me the eyes to see as you see, so
that's
that I can heal to the deepest of the root, uproot and destroy every lie of the enemy. I want to be free." Just identifying the need to be free.
Amen. Khalilah, I thank you so much for being on the show. I appreciate all the contributions you have made to the success of my show, and I pray that God will bring that manifold blessings upon you and your book and your family and your ministry. Bless you, ladies, who were on the show as well. You know, Laura Bush said that the power of a book lies in its power to turn a solitary act into a shared vision. The Bible says to write the vision and make it plain so that one who reads it may run. That's Habakkuk 2:2. Now, that's wisdom to reign. To make a donation or get in touch with me or my team, please go to www.wealthmngt.org or follow us on Facebook and Twitter at iReign, Stop Abuse, and Fight Back. Again, I want to thank Never Had It So Good Sports Media Network. Let's reign together with Christ. I'll see you next Thursday at 8. Happy New Year!
Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
All right. Bye-bye, ladies. Bye-bye, everyone.
Bye-bye. Bye.
It's like you're looking through a telescope.
You see where you're going to be.